We are Gilbert and George. We are so happy and pleased to be here in Belfast with our scapegoating pictures.
The scapegoating pictures.
At the Mac. We're especially proud to be able to show these pictures here because we've shown them in London and Paris, and we've shown them in a very beautiful church in Berlin, which was very exciting, an active church. So it was still in use. You can imagine the wedding photographs, for instance.
For us, these pictures, the scapegoating pictures, are probably some of the most intense pictures that we ever made. For us, some of the best ones, because they are creating a new feeling, what is going on in front of our door in London. And we feel the whole world is changing, and we are trying to freeze time in some extraordinary way.
So we feel, as we always did, that whatever's happening in front of our door is also happening all over the world. And we think that we should all be aware in that same way, because then we are part of the whole. We wouldn't like to be the artists living in the country, reading about it all in the newspapers. We want to be in the thick of it.
And it's quite interesting, because our art has always been part of, we are the art. We are the journey that we're going towards the end. And we see life in front of us, and we want to concentrate it on how we can change life, how we should, what we call the evil and good that is in front of us. We want to be part of that.
So we are dealing and trying to feel around all of those simple things that are very complicated, that lie inside all of us wherever we live on this extraordinary planet. So we're trying to tackle death,
hope,
life,
fear,
sex,
money,
race,
and religion.
And in that way, we feel we can explore everything that's inside us and inside the viewer, because we are here for the viewer.
It's quite interesting, because when we start to become artists for the first time after leaving St. Martin School of Art, the journey was, the idea was that we were the center of our art. We were the artist who speak. We were the living sculptor. We were the marble that speak. And that was a meeting invention for us. And that's where we're able to leave behind the idea for art's sake. We made an art that is for life's sake. The journey is in front of us, how we confront life, how we confront good and evil, how we confront morality. That's all based on our art.
We weren't leaving St. Martin's trying to be artists, trying to get a grant, trying to get a part-time job, struggling to become artists. We didn't think that. We felt we were artists. And we weren't exploring how to become artists. We were exploring our life through London, because we were country people. And so we would walk all the time through London. And one magic day, we were walking near Euston Station, and we came across a strange utopian housing estate. It was painted white. And it was in a place called Summertown, which had a wonderful name. And it was beautiful houses in a sort of round arrangement with gardens. And in front on the street, there was a series of retail units. One was a very ordinary washateria, the other was a liquor shop. And one was a shop which sold all of the things that people leave behind in their flat when they leave. So when people vacated one of those flats, all of the objects that left were in that shop. And we were fascinated by that. We've always been fascinated by the detritus of life. What is left over? What is in the gutter? What is not of interest to anyone? And we wandered into that shop, and for some funny reason, a gramophone record found us. We don't think we found it. We think it found us. And we went back to Fournier Street, and we tried to buy, and then we managed to succeed to buy a wind-up gramophone. And we were amazed as we played it and we joined in to sing it, that it was like us. It was a portrait of us. It was a song out of date, but still quite timeless. And it was a sort of song about people who are not very privileged, but being very happy and very determined and managing to get along. And the song, the words were extraordinary. It was the Ritz we never sigh for, the Carlton they can keep. There's only one place that I know, and that is where I sleep. Underneath the arches, I dream my dreams away.
Underneath the arches, on cobblestones we lay. Every night you find me, tired out and worn, happy when the daylight comes creeping, heralding the dawn. Sleeping when it's raining, and sleeping when it's fine. La di 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 da 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 da. Pavement is our pillow, no matter where we stray. Underneath the arches, I dream my dreams away.
And that was the sculpture that took us all over the world. And it made us the living sculptors.
It launched us into Europe, and it launched us into America. Then we were launched into Australasia. It was extraordinary. And we still believe very much in the idea of the human person and the difficulties in life, which everyone in the world, wherever you are, can understand. It's very, very simple, very complicated, but also very simple.
It was quite interesting because once we left St. Martin's School of Art, we were stranded outsiders, and we were able that because we wanted to make an emotional art, and the emotion not with one person, but two people. It became a living, what you call, a living composition with two people. We were able to, what you call, walk the streets and art and being artworks. That was extraordinary development. And we were able to put all our feelings that we had as young people, all the sexuality, all the drinking part, all the young people, all the landscape of East End of London, all into our art, all the emotions. It became emotional art. And that's quite different than any art at that time that was able to be human. We were able to make a human art because in the end, we only believe in humans and nothing else.
Because we saw around us the teachers and the students had a belief in the form of art, in the shape, the color, the angle, never the content. They never thought of that. And we didn't want to do art about art. We didn't want formalism. And we didn't want to be like our teachers who thought that art was something superior to all those people outside. They thought that anyone outside of the studio or the gallery was stupid. And we always knew from the earliest day that sitting in Fournier Street on the ground floor with our two green chairs and watching people go by, and we realized that every single person is amazing in some way or another.
And we were able, along at the beginning, at the first year, we were exploring different ways of making art. We had the living sculpture that was the most important part of it, us as art. And then we're trying to leave something behind in this place. You know? So we tried out to have a little, what you call, mailing art we used to send out, you know? Telling them about our, what you call, our living sculpture, our standing in the room, and the snow was falling outside. So creating what you call a three-dimensional story. And then we started to do these big drawings because Conrad Fischer told us, why don't you leave something behind, no? And we have to find a way of leaving. We didn't want to be artists. We want to be like leaving messages behind, no?
We didn't want to be like the other artists.
Yeah.
We felt different. We felt underprivileged. We felt different in every single way. And he said, you must make something for the gallery. And so we thought very simply that we should do what we know and what we think about. And looking back, it seems very simplified, but we felt at that time that all we knew was walking, which is what we did all the day, walking in London, viewing, which we were doing, and relaxing, of course. So we did this three-part charcoal on paper sculpture, walking, viewing, relaxing. Again, very complicated, but very simple at the same time.
Putting on our responsibility suits of our art, that was it all about. And then we were able to invent a new form how to speak with the negative and to make it more aggressive and more direct. And I think that language that we invented for ourselves is this language that you see here in Belfast, because we were able to speak in a fantastic way, and not, we never liked the whole idea of artistic hands behind it. We only want the message in front of us. And it was, and it's still doing the same. After that, we never changed the system, how to make art.
And of course, having created walking, viewing, relaxing, It paved the way, because he said, after the opening, so how much will it be? And we hadn't had a price in mind. We never sold a work of art. We never thought of selling a work of art, unlike our contemporaries who were concentrating on trying to achieve that. And we thought, well, how much should it be? So we just said something, some astronomical sum, because we knew it wasn't going to be sold, so it might as well have a grand price. So we said, all very sophisticated and relaxed, over £1,000. And the next day, he sold it. And that changed our life in another way. Then began the drinking sculptures. We were able to go around all over the world with friends, celebrating, exploring life in yet another way.
And the new way of making art through taking pictures is extraordinary, because you are able to build up what they call a dictionary of subjects. No? Every time we do a new group of pictures, we are going out and take images. What speaks to us? What is today speaking to us? And all together, maybe we take like 10 or 15,000 images and we put them together in subjects, all like inside, outside, religion, non-religion, dirt, and all the stuff, skies. And then we make our designs. And that's extraordinary. That's the artistic part, when we create our design. And our design have to be taken from what we feel without thinking too much in a dark room. That's what we make them, in a dark room. And the inner thoughts are coming out, because we always feel we never want to look at life. We only want to see the inner life, what inside ourselves. No? Even when you see the scapegoating pictures are upset, all the writings on the wall, there's the inner feelings that we feel.
That everyone understands. I think one of the extraordinary things is the act of creating, and that's very, very difficult to explain, because as we said before, everything's very simple and very complicated at the same time. And it is a mystery partly to us. We don't know exactly how we got around to making any one of our pictures. Sometimes we go down to the studio in the morning and see the design for the picture we made yesterday. We wouldn't be able to quantify exactly how that had happened. It's rather like gathering the images in the first place. We don't really know why we're getting them together, but we do know that we're looking for the moral dimension. That's why when we did the Dirty Words pictures in 1977, everyone thought that we were being very childish and very silly and over the top, even our closest friends and admirers. And then 25 years later, when we showed all of the Dirty Words pictures together for the first time, and some of the people who were awkward about them all those years ago came to see them and said, told us how much they loved the pictures. And we said, don't you remember? You didn't think like that 25 years ago. And they said, no, we've always loved those pictures. And that's a very good example of how the picture stays there, but the world changes around them.
It's quite interesting, because 3 or 4 years ago, when we started the walks of East End of London, we saw everything change for the first time. We started to see what they call the young people in East End of London all using laughing gas to make themselves high. And we started to see all these little bombs on the streets. And at the same time, we walked the streets of Whitechapel and we started to see all burqa ladies, all stop, all non-stop. And that's an amazing combination. And at the same time, we started to see all the news, newspapers and television, that everybody was blown up all over the world in the name of religion. And that's what we, and it's quite interesting, because the secular society, they don't know what to think about the whole thing.
That's why we say that we all, everyone, they are Greek, Roman, Judeo-Christian secularists, or they are Greek, Roman, Judeo-Christian secularist Christians. It's whether you believe that or not, that's what we are. That's what the whole of mankind has arranged for us so far. And we think that in our small way as artists, we can work on that we can contribute to that.
We only believe in being friendly to each other, without religion. That's the only way that we will succeed to succeed to being and having a new world. I really believe that. Ban religion, that is our motto, has been for a long time, because it just creates unhappiness and unhappiness.
We think only one way would be to get out of the whole thing, and that is if the church and the church authorities, whichever ones, they're all there, would apologize for once. Because once after trouble, if you apologize, then you can start fresh. If you don't apologize, you can never get on with it. You've got to apologize first.
This whole idea of religion is so much based on intolerance. It's all based on intolerance towards other people. And we realize that that's an amazing subject for us to be involved in, because even the whole intolerance towards us for many, many years, calling us all kind of names. No? And that's all about a religious intolerance in some way. And that's what we are fighting in some way, because we realize that ordinary people cannot even get married to the other side because they're all religious problems. And even the whole idea of sexuality, you know, was all laid down by religions, you know, how to behave. And we as secular people, that we managed to sort it out for ourselves, we are quite happy. Even after all, all the vicars shouted even towards me for 50 years what they call hell and damnation non-stop. And we were able to say to ourselves, there is no God. And we believe that we know as much about God than anybody else. Nothing.